May this be a time when we remember your faithfulness. You give us hope when despair creeps into our lives. You carve out a path when we lack direction. You send family members, friends, and even strangers when we need to be reminded of your promise. And you send Jesus Christ, your beloved Son, to us to show us how to live in your ways. May we in this day open our hearts to receive all that you provide. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
These can be new or gently used in all sizes. Please leave them in the foyer in the tote. The next pancake breakfast will be October 13th at 9 a.m. and this money will go towards the Sacred Ground mission trip. September 29th is the administrative council meeting right after the morning service. September 29th is also the nursing home visitation at 2:30. And then the next youth meeting will be here on October 6th at 5 p.m. Are there any other announcements?
Yes, I did finally put a sign-up sheet back there for anyone who would like to help provide meals for the youth, for their youth meetings. There's dates on there for when we need them. It's there on the place where you normally pick up your bulletins. If you'd like to sign up to help with one of the meals, please do so. Our first one that we're responsible for is next Sunday the 6th. And also, the admin council meeting that is after church, I need at least members. I need some members from my financial committee. I need members from SBRC. I need a member or two at least from all of my committees. So if you're on a committee and you can stay for a few minutes, please do so, because we have a couple of important forms I need you guys to look at. So if you can stay for a few minutes, please do so for this meeting after church.
Anything else?
UMW will meet Tuesday, 6 o'clock, here at the church.
Okay, if there's nothing else, please stand for the call to worship. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Oh,
off. You may be seated. Our words of assurance today come to us from Psalms chapter 91. My refuge and my fortress, God is who I trust. May we trust the forgiveness of God that sets us free and enables us to be joyful people of God. Amen. Now it's time for our young folks' time. Children will come forward. You knew that? You just didn't remember, huh? Okay. Well, now what do you think it means to live a good life? What's an example of living a good life? Can anyone give me one?
Being a Christian.
Being a Christian, okay, that's a really good one. What else?
Sitting there nicely.
Sitting there nicely. Being a good kiddo in the pews. Yes, that's a good one. I like that. That's a good one. What else? Anybody else got any ideas of what it lives, what it means? To live a good life? What about all the things that we take for granted? Like food, and plenty to drink. Lemonade will help us live a good life. Everybody needs plenty of lemonade. That's the good thing. That'll help you live a good life right there. And what about when it rains, we have a jacket to put on, and we have a place to stay in shelter, right? Right, to stay cozy, that's right.
You have to put a scarf on your neck so we don't get rained
on. Scarf on your neck so you don't get rained on. What about when it's really, really hot outside? What does everybody love?
Going shirtless.
Not going shirtless. Air conditioning, right? Everybody likes air conditioning.
You have to stay inside.
You have to stay inside where it's air conditioned and cool. Right. If you get sick, you have to go to the hospital. So you stay inside when it's too hot. So these are all examples of what it's like to live a good life, right? You have plenty to eat. You have plenty to drink. You have a place to go home to. It's nice and cool when it's hot outside. It's nice and warm when it's too cold outside. And you have a life where you can sit in the pews and be a good kiddo. You live a Christian life. All these are great examples, right? So what if I told you that God loves us, and that God wants us all to live a good life. He wants every one of us to have all these wonderful things that help us to live a good life, even lemonade. You learn about Jesus in your class at school? That's great. I'm glad that they teach that. So we all learn to live a good life, and we all know that God helps us with that, right? So can we help others to live a good life too? We can do that, right? If you see someone that's mowing the lawn and it's really hot outside and they don't have a drink of water, you go take one to them, right? Or, yes. You put my water up there for me. Thank you very much. So we take care of other people because God wants us to help others to live a good life if we see people that aren't, right? If someone's hungry, if they haven't eaten in a good while and they come to you and they say, can you get me some food? We try to do that, right? God intends for everybody to live a good life, even those that we don't think about, those who don't know who God is. He wants to learn more about them, and He wants them to learn about Him. So we have to help them, right? We have to help them to know who He is, and we have to help them when they're thirsty, or when they're cold, or when they need food, right? Yes, fresh lemonade, too. So let us think about that today as we listen to our sermon, and let us go to the Lord in prayer, okay? Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for your love for us. Thank you for helping us to live a good life and for letting us know that we can help others too. Fill us with your love always, for it's in your name we pray. Amen. I upgraded my candy bowl this week.
Yeah.
You've already been in it, haven't you? Okay. Good deal. Thanks, guys. And now we're going to be blessed with the choir singing.
I'm double clicking on it, Brandy, and it's not coming up.
It's you.
I don't. It won't play.
Thank you.
It's always wonderful when there's a choir behind me so I don't have to sing very loud. I can let them do all the work. That was great. The ushers will come forward now for our tithe and offering. Let us be in the spirit of prayer. Father, we come to you today to say thank you. Thank you for loving us and for blessing us richly beyond anything we can imagine. We ask that you will fill our hearts as we give back to you these blessings that you give us. And use them, Lord, for your service to your kingdom. For it's in your precious name we pray. Amen. Others this morning.
Pat Brown. She yes. Started her new treatment this week. She is in a lot of pain. She does not need visitors, but she loves to get texts on her phone, and then she feels like it. She'll return those. She didn't feel like it yesterday, so she wants to call me. Just keep her in your prayers.
Continue to remember Pat in your prayers as she starts the new treatments. Others to uplift today. Continue to keep Lindsay's grandmother in your prayers. She's doing somewhat better, but seems like they get one thing fixed and another thing starts going on. So keep her in your prayers.
Keep my son Mark Johnson in your prayers. I take him to the Heart Hospital tomorrow for a procedure, and maybe we'll get some answers.
Mark Johnson, keep him in your prayers as he's going for a procedure at the Heart Hospital. Keep Sharon in your prayers. How's Sharon doing, Carol?
She's home. She's doing a bit better. She wasn't quite up to come to church today.
others to uplift today. Of course, let's continue to keep our country in your prayers, keep our churches throughout the world in your prayers. There's so much going on and so much hatred that's going on around the world. We need to continue to pray. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Put Bill Conrad on your prayer list. He is scheduled to see surgeons in Hot Springs this next week.
Keep Bill in your prayers.
Yeah, please.
He's going to see, do some consultation next week. Others to uplift. If not, then let us go together in the spirit of prayer to the Lord. Our most precious and heavenly Father, this morning we come to you to say thank you. Thank you for richly blessing us. Thank you for being our rock and our salvation. Thank you, Lord, for your strength in times when we need it most. And Father, we thank you for the privilege that we Christians have that we can come to you in prayer no matter where we're at, no matter what we're doing, and you hear our prayers. And you answer them, Lord, in your own way, in your own time. Father, thank you for waking us up this morning. Father, thank you for bringing us here to worship you today. Thank you that we still have the freedom to worship you. Father, we thank you for those that put their lives on the line for us every day, whether it be EMTs, firefighters, police officers, or those in our military. Thank you for their service to us. Thank you, Lord, for being here for us every day. Father, thank you for the sacrifice that you made for us. Thank you, Lord, for letting us live in ways that are so great. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us every day. Thank you for all that you are and for all that you do for us. We ask now that you will be with us as we continue through this new day. Watch over us, Lord. We pray that you will lift up those who were brought up this morning. Lord, we pray that you will be with those who are being silently lifted to you right now. Father, give comfort where comfort is needed. Give strength where strength is needed. Give healing where healing is needed. And give peace where peace is needed. Father, we pray that you will continue to be with our country. Lord, lift up those who are leading us. Let them lead in a way that will be pleasing unto you. Be with us as churches, Lord. Guide our hearts, guide our minds, guide our spirits to be a light in this world. Let us show your love wherever we're at and wherever we're going. And Lord, strengthen us on our journey. Father, we pray that you will be with those who we said thank you for earlier. Those who put their lives on the line for us every day. Watch over them and be with their families as well. And Father, we pray that you will replace all the hatred that is in this world with your love. Replace it with your Holy Spirit. Let us find peace with each other. Lord, guide us, strengthen us, and help us every day to do your will. And Father, we again say thank you for all that you are and for all that you do. As we come together now in the prayer that you gave us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us stand now as we sing our hymn of preparation, one verse of the beautiful garden of prayer.
Instruct them to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous, willing to share, storing up for themselves a good foundation for the age to come, so that they may take hold of the life that is real. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. You may be seated. How thoughtful of Emerson to leave me a water bottle up here. One day there was this man who was an atheist, and he was going through the woods, and he was enjoying his little walk, and he was admiring the beauty of everything around him. He'd look at the trees and he'd say, "Oh, how majestic, how tall, how beautiful those trees are, how great they are, and how tall and wonderful." And then he would look at the creek and he would say, "Oh, how peaceful it is to hear the water going over the stones, and how wonderful and clear the water is." Then he would look at the sky and he'd say, "Oh, what a beautiful sky, how the sunshine is so bright and keeps me warm on this cool day. It's so wonderful." And as he continued his walk, suddenly there was a bear up on him. And he cried out, he said, "Oh, God." And there was a pause. Everything went totally still. And there was a voice from above, and it said, "Why are you calling upon me now after all these years of not believing and not listening to what I've had to say to you? I've tried to reach out to you, and you've never come. I will hear, though, your plea of help. What is it you desire?" The man says, "Oh, Lord, I've lived such a terrible life. I've persecuted Christians every chance I got. I've hated people. And I've been against Christianity, and I'm not even sure that I believe my eyes and ears right now. Oh, it would be terrible for me to ask you to make me a Christian. But could you please make the bear a Christian?" At that very moment, God said, "Okay, it's done." Everything started and went back to normal. So the man looks up, and he sees this bear, and the bear is bowed with his paws together. And he says, "Thank you, O Lord, for this meal that I'm about to enjoy. Amen." The longer and longer that I live in this world, and more that I study and learn, the more that I have decided that humanity is pretty dumb. And that's not a direct remark on anybody in particular, but humanity in general is not that smart. Now we've done some wonderful things. We've created some great stuff. We've done amazing things, but we're just stubborn-headed and really not that smart. See, we have this wonderful God right in front of us. And this amazing, wonderful God wants to richly bless us. But for one, we're not exactly sure what it is we need from God. And then the ones of us that do kind of understand what it is that we need from God, we're not really 100% sure how it is that we're supposed to ask for it. Now, part of the problem, I think, is that over the years, our brains have kind of gotten crosswired a little bit, and we don't always make a whole lot of sense to even ourselves. And I've come to that conclusion because born within mankind is a desire to know God. God put that into every single person that He created, and He created us all in His image. And there is an innate desire, a curiosity, so to speak, to know who this God is and to search Him out as He continues to search for us. And some people, and I'm really not sure why and I'm really not sure how, they decided to turn this desire off. Or they have found a way to ignore that small plea that God is always calling for us, always wanting us to come to Him, to have a better relationship with Him. See, God, once we come to know Him and once we come to know Christ, doesn't just want us to stay where we're at. He says, once you get to know Me and once you start to grow with Me, I want that relationship to continue to develop, to be better and better. I want you to come to know My love so amazing and so greatly that it overwhelms you. God does not want us to stay where we're at. But we live in this world where we can have anything we want just a moment's notice. I could type in something on Amazon and I could order it up and I could have it here tomorrow. And I guess if you lived in some of the bigger cities, you could type it into Amazon and they deliver it to your doorstep in the next hour or two. So we've come to the point where we feel like that we can get anywhere, we can do anything, we can be more than what we want to be, and we don't always need God. That's the situation in the society that we live in now. We can have anything we want, we can be anything we want, we can grow into whatever we want. But then what about those who don't quite have the same amount of resources as most of us do? What about those who can't go to Amazon and order whatever they feel like? In fact, there are those who are struggling to know what they're going to eat tonight or if they're going to have a meal in front of them this evening. What about that type of a person? What about those who still don't know who God is? Our scripture today, the first thing it does is reminds us that we are to be the people of God. To live a life in the way that God intended us to. If you guys remember last week, we talked about how God wants us to live in all goodness, in all love. He wants us to live in peace and dignity. We're called to follow Christ. We're called to not let these things of the world get to us. We're called to hear what it is that God is wanting us to hear. And to be able to block out all the things of the world. See, when we build this relationship with God, and as it continues to grow and as it continues to develop, we start to feel this peace. We start to have this calm. We start to have this ability to live godly and dignified lives. And hopefully we realize that while we are searching to gain better understanding of God and to learn more about Him and to get closer to Him, He's constantly doing the same to us. He's pulling us in. He's asking us to learn more, to be more, to understand Him better, and to feel His presence in our lives. We have to live in His love. We have to be able to endure, to fight the good fight of the faith. Paul says that we confess to God and before everyone our desire to live in a manner that is pleasing to Him. And then he says that we confess that we believe in eternal life, and then Paul lays it all right there in front of us. He said, God gives life to all things. God gives life to all things, and we are to keep His commands until Jesus Christ the Savior comes back. We skipped a couple of verses, and those verses are in there, and I think that there's a couple of things I want to say about them. They say that God is King of kings and Lord of lords. Think about that for just a second. King of kings and Lord of lords. So who else would we want to put our trust in but God? Paul says, let him lead you. And then you'll understand what it was that we talked about last week. That life of peace. Living in a godly life. And then Paul concludes his letter in a little bit of a different way. He talks to Timothy and he gives him a warning. He says, I want you to know that people who are rich are to give generously, to live their lives in a way. Now, I'll preface this by saying I don't think that he was talking about the people that own Walmart and that kind of richness. I think that what he was talking about here are people who have plenty, who have enough in abundance, who are able to sustain their lives as they are and still have some left over. He's talking to those type of people. He's saying that we have resources that we can use to help others and that we can do it. He's saying to live a generous life and not to worry about anything because God will take care of you. Paul is using this last part of this letter to tell the people in Timothy to live a life of service. He says, don't set your hopes on uncertain things. He says, don't set your hopes on Amazon being able to deliver on time. He's saying, don't set your hopes on the things of this world, the things that could go away, your vacation that you've got scheduled to take next year. He's saying that could get rained out. He's saying there are many things that could happen to ruin our own thoughts, our own desires, our own wants. But if we will turn to God, everything that we need, He will take care of it. He will give generously to the point where we're able to give generously as well. Do good works, he says. Be ready to share. He says there's no need for us to store up great treasures on earth because our treasures are in heaven. For a while there, Emerson really liked the very first Chipmunks movie that came out. She did that. It was one of her favorites. I could probably just about quote the whole movie by now. And there was a particular scene in that movie, and Dave has gone off somewhere. And while he's gone, he comes back into his house, and the Chipmunks have stored waffles under the cushions. They've stored food here. They've poured syrup everywhere. There's all kinds of cereal all over the place, and they're trying to store it in anything that they possibly can. They got their little mouths as full as they can get them. And Dave says, guys, what are you doing? You don't have to store food up for the winter here. We can go to the grocery store and buy more. And then one of the Chipmunks turns back to him and says, we're Chipmunks, Dave. It's what we do. We store supplies up for the winter because we never know when we're going to run out. We're kind of like that as humans. We're a little bit like those chipmunks. We start to store stuff up and store stuff up and store stuff up, and eventually we have a storage building over here that half the stuff we don't even know what's in it anymore. That happens to me. We got a storage building that we've cleaned out and I found stuff I didn't even know existed. But God is saying, don't worry about that. All these things that we have, God is going to give generously. When we lose hope, when we're at our last end, God is always there to pick us back up. God is always there to take care of us. He says, don't worry about all that extra that you have in your savings account. Now, having a savings account is a good thing. There's always the possibility of an emergency. But he's saying, I will take care of you. My generosity will be more than you can understand. But we're stubborn sometimes. Humans are stubborn individuals. God calls us to a life of generosity. He calls us to a life of greatness. He calls us to live well. And Paul says it specifically in here. He says, God will take care of you, and God will give you these things for your enjoyment. What do you think about that? See, God just doesn't want us to live our lives humdrum and walking around with our heads down. He says, I give you these things for your enjoyment. He wants us to live well. He wants us to be happy. But he also wants us to live generously. Generosity, gentleness, righteousness. All these things, if we do them, we can enjoy a life of peace and dignity and godliness. So how do we give up? How do we get to live a good life? It's simple. We give up on our stubbornness, and we just know that God is searching for us, is building us up, is wanting us to have a stronger and a better relationship with Him. And He's pulling us through the worst of times. And He's telling us, I know your sins and they've all been forgiven. If you live with me, I will live in you. So how do you live a good life? By remembering God's grace and by being generous every chance we get. Righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance. Remember these simple things and remember that God loves you. That's how we live well. Let us go together to the Lord in prayer. Our most precious and heavenly Father, we come to you today to say thank you. Thank you for blessing us so richly and generously. And we ask, Lord, that you will guide our hearts, lead us as we want to be generous with what you've given us. Strengthen us every day and fill us always with your love and your Holy Spirit. For it's in your precious name we pray. Our closing hymn today is Power in the Blood. Let us stand and sing together. Meeting right after church. I need members from every committee to be available for that. And also at 2:30, we go to visit the nursing home. Today, we're going out to the crossing, so we'll gather there around 2:30. It'll be a good time for everyone. Let us be in the spirit of prayer as we close. Father, for all that you are and for all that you do, we say thank you and praise you. For this worship service that we've had together, we say thank you and praise you. We ask now that you will help us to take this worship with us as we go through this new day and this new week. Fill our hearts always with your love and your Holy Spirit. For it's in your precious name we pray. Amen.